Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to McDougal Chapel Online. We're so happy you could join us. It's just amazing that we can just sit here on your couches, or there's a few people in the pews here today, but we can just sit here and we can worship God. It doesn't matter where we are, or it doesn't matter our circumstances. We can still give God honor and glory. We want to welcome you to our service. That's exactly what we want to do today, is give God honor and glory. A passage I want to read to you is Colossians 3, verse 11. It's a passage I'm going to be preaching on during this service, and it goes like this. It says, in this life, in this new life, it doesn't matter if you are a Jew or Gentile, if you're barbaric or uncivilized or a slave or free, Christ is all that matters, and he lives in all of us. And that's kind of the truth that we kind of hold on to. It doesn't matter where you come from, or what your circumstances are, or how awesome things are going, or how poorly things are going. Christ is all that matters, and he lives in all of us, and that's why we're here today. We're worshiping God together. Let's pray for this service. Heavenly Father, thank you for being a part of us. Thank you for giving us the new life. And I pray right now is that we move into the service, that everything that we say and everything we do would reflect the fact that we're thankful for that new life you've given us. You accept us the way we are, no matter where we come from, and we rejoice for that. Thank you, Lord. In your name we pray, amen. A couple of announcements that we want to just kind of share with you and remind you of is that on McDougalChapel.com, you're going to find all this information that I'm going to share. But two of the main things that we want to let you know about is that Plus One is our food hamper system that we do here in Sundry and through McDougal Chapel, and as a part of not only our church, but the whole ministerial. But if you know of somebody that needs a hamper, or maybe you need a hamper, just call 403-636-0554, and we would love to make sure that you got one. There's no questions asked. We want to just bless the people in our community. Also, if you probably noticed that we don't hand around offering bags online, but if you'd like to give to our ministry, if you'd like to give to McDougal Chapel, you can do it through e-transfer at donations@mcdougalchapel.com, and that money goes towards our daily expenses that we still have as a church. Even though COVID's going on, we still do have some expenses. If you would like to come by the office at any time, the doors are always locked, so you can't get in, but there is a doorbell outside you can push, and someone will answer it, and we would love to have you come by. We can sit on the picnic table and visit. I'm open to any kind of coffees now, and the rules are seem to be loosened a little bit, and it's so awesome to be able to see people face-to-face now. Also, I just want to remind you that next week we're going to be having communion. And what that means is that usually we used to have these little cups with juice in them and then bread that we passed around, but we can't do that anymore. So I'm going to ask that if you want to experience a really unique communion service, come to one of our services. We have a service on Thursday night when we record, and then also on Sunday morning as we watch the worship and you get some live preaching from myself. But we are going to have communion. It's going to be very unique. So make sure you phone myself at 403-638-7357 or the church office, and make sure you book your seat, because we only allow 30 people into our building at a time, but we want to celebrate communion together, and it's going to be a fun service next week. So with that, I'm going to just turn it over to the worship team, and we're going to get back to our worship time.
Love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me. Oh, my fears and failures, fill my life again. I give my life. Pour out our praise.
Good morning. We are thrilled to have some people in the pews today. Thank you all for coming, and we miss all of you who are at home. I just want to start by reading a familiar passage of Scripture. It's from Matthew chapter 6. So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Let's see if I can juggle two things at once here. I've been thinking a lot about prayer in these last few months, and thought about a book that I did a study on with our church, actually. It has to be 6 or 7 or 8 years ago now. But it really touched me, and I want to read just a little part of the very end of the book so it gives you a picture. You should go read it. The urgent need of today's church is not better management, more programs, stronger opposition to moral evil in our culture, or a clearer statement of biblical principles to follow in dealing with our lives. We must return to worship as participation by the Spirit in the Son's relationship with the Father. We must return to the Bible as the one book God wrote to reveal who He is, what He's doing in the unseen world, and what His power can do in our hearts. And we must return to prayer as our opportunity not to get a better life of more blessings now, but to enter more intimately into relationship with God. And that's my desire in my prayer life, is that it's not about what I can get from God, what I ask Him for, what I need or think I need, but rather just to draw closer to Him. And so I hope that's your desire as well. So today as we pray, we want to focus on our pastors and leaders of our towns, our cities, our province, and our country. It's been more than two full months now, and they need wisdom. Our pastors need wisdom in knowing how to proceed. Our leaders of our country need wisdom. So we're going to pray for them. So let's just go to prayer together. Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for who you are, your love for us. I just pray that as we worship today, that the desire of our hearts would be simply to draw closer to you, to get to know you more, to become more like you. That it wouldn't be about what we can get from it or what we need or think we need or want, or but that we would just long for you. I think today of the pastors of churches in our community, specifically of Pastor Kent, and as each of them just strives to follow you in the way that they are leading, I just pray that you would give them wisdom and guidance. Just make it clear to them what you want in all of this and how you want them to lead. Give them the strength that they need, as even though it might seem like there isn't as much going on, sometimes that can be even more wearing because it's different, and different things wear us down mentally too. So I just pray that you would give them the strength that they need. Think of the leaders of our town, our province, our country, and I just pray that you would give them wisdom, that you would use them to bring about your glory, that even if we don't agree with everything they're doing, you are in control, and I just pray that you would work through them, that you would turn our country towards you. So as we go through this week, I just pray that we would just seek you more, that we would seek you first, and you'll worry about everything else, and that we would just focus on you. Pray for Pastor Kent now as he comes to share, that you would give him the words you want him to speak today, that you would be working in each one of our hearts, and that we would take home what we learn and do something about it, not just let it fall by the wayside. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, thanks, Heidi, for leading us in that prayer time. And coming in here today, I had no idea that the focus was going to be on pastors and leaders, and the timing was good. The timings are good. It's one of those weeks where you go, am I even doing the right things as a pastor or a leader of a church? And even us pastors have so many times where we feel so insignificant and so lacking wisdom or whatever we need. And so it's good to be prayed for. So please continue to do so. And also, I need to tell Rachel this from up front, but your worship is a blessing to us. And I've had a few people that have actually talked to me and said, we go check out your services online because of Rachel's music, not because of my preaching. It's hard on my ego, but I'm okay with it. I'm kind of working through that. But we've been blessed to have you and your team, Ben and Randy and Laurel today and Dawn. You guys have been a blessing to us, and we appreciate you so much. Many of you that know me know that I've been taking a course in the States for the last 2 years, and it gives me a chance to get out of the country and kind of stretch my legs a little bit, and I like adventure and look around for new things to be adventurous with. And one thing I've done is I've made observations of my times down to the States. And a couple of the observations kind of go like this. I don't know if you know this, but when you go to the States, it seems like everywhere you go, the food portions are giant. Has anyone ever noticed that before? You can't go into a restaurant, or you can't go into a little diner, and you know, you order something really simple, and next thing you know, you get this giant plate, comes in two courses, and it's just all this food. And that's one of my observations. The other observation I've had is when I've talked to people that are in the States, especially in the southern states, and they find out that you're from Canada, they go, the questions they have about Canada are awesome. because they really have no idea what Canada's like. They have no idea how big it is. You know, the stories that go about someone asking the question, hey, do you know my cousin Jane in Toronto? You know, like that's really true. People do ask those kinds of questions because they have no idea how big Canada is. And I love being able to inform them, and I love the veil being pulled back in their knowledge of Canada as we speak together, and it's just an awesome feeling. But I've also noticed, and this is the kind of thing that I want to focus on today, I've noticed that when you go to the States, you don't have to say you're Canadian. People figure it out with you without even saying it. And I don't know what it is, but maybe it's because we're super friendly, or maybe it's because I say A a lot, or maybe it's because I have an accent. I don't know what it is, but people can kind of point out a Canadian really easily, especially when you move away from the tourist areas. They go, you're not from around here, are you? And I get that quite a bit. I was at Arizona University in Tucson, Arizona, and I was just kind of wandering around. I had lunch somewhere on campus, and I just wanted to see the university sites. And you got to know that the universities in the States are way different than universities in Canada. There's just a different feel. There's a different culture that's part of that. So I was just kind of wandering around, and I was having lunch. I stopped for lunch, and there was a guy sitting at a picnic table, one table over. It was about 100 degrees outside, and kid you not, and I was sitting outside under some shade and just enjoying my lunch. And he was just kind of watching me, and I was watching him. And he gets up to leave, and he goes, well, where are you from? I noticed you're not from around here, just like I said, right? And he, for some reason, he picked up on that. Of the fact that I was a Canadian and I was a tourist. And I didn't know I looked like a tourist. It could have been my pasty white skin. I don't know when I'm in Arizona. That could have given it away. But whatever it was, he kind of pointed that out to me, that I wasn't from there. We had a great chat. He told me about things to go see and things I could do while I was in Tucson. And then he went on his way. And it left me wondering, what did he see in me that made me stand out as someone that was a foreigner? What did I do? What did I say? How did I act? And it comes down to the simple fact that no matter who we are, no matter where you come from, but you carry an identity just by being you. And when I'm in the States, I carry an identity just by being me, just because that's who I am. We're going to continue our series that we're going through on the book of Colossians. And the scene takes place in the city of Colossae. And Colossae was a typical Roman city in Asia Minor, and where everything around the city, this whole city actually, was built around a pagan attitude, meaning that there was many gods and there's many different types of religions and there's lots of immorality going on. You know, in the temples were prostitutes and there were sacrifices going on that were just horrible. And that's the kind of town that Colossae was. And it was typical for a Roman town and a Roman settlement at that time. And in this city lived a man named Epaphras. And Epaphras one day was in another city. He was in Ephesus. I don't know what he was doing there, but he was in Ephesus. But he was from Colossae, and he traveled to Ephesus, and he ran into a man named Paul. And Paul was teaching, and he was teaching about another God. A God that says, I want to have a relationship with you. And he was preaching about a God that was full of grace, who sent his only son to die on a cross so you could have forgiveness. And Epaphras goes, tell me more about this God. And he came to know about our Lord and Savior. He came to know about Jesus Christ, who by trusting in him, his sins could be forgiven. And by trusting in him, he could live forever and have hope. And Epaphras believed and became a follower of Jesus. So Epaphras couldn't keep his mouth shut. He goes back to Colossae, and he started to tell people that were around him about this man that he met, Paul, and about how he built and found a new relationship in Jesus Christ. And the first church was started in Colossae. Now you got to think about it. This little church in the middle of a community that's pagan, and what's going to happen to this church? Everywhere you turn and everywhere you look, the immorality of that community was going to try to be seeping into that church, whether they liked it or not. And that church was at risk. They were at total risk. Risk of just forgetting who they were as followers of Jesus and giving into the pressures that they were experiencing as new believers in Jesus Christ. Now, those pressures that they were facing, you need to know, we're not much different than the pressures that we face as a church in North America today. We are in the middle of a firestorm. There's things going around us that we don't even know about, guaranteed. And the question that we have to ask is, what can we learn from this book of Colossians that can help us through these times, just like it helped the church in Colossae, to be a church that represents Christ well? So up until this point, we've really talked about Paul's been writing this letter, and he's been concerned about this church, and he's really talked about who those people weren't. He says, don't fall into the trap of different religions, and don't fall into the trap of going with traditions or whatever it may be. Make sure you focus on Jesus Christ. And today he's going to tell us something a little different. He's going to tell us exactly who they are. Not who they weren't and who they aren't supposed to be, but who they are. And he's going to help define to them what a Christian really is. Now, identity is a hot topic. It was a hot topic 2,000 years ago. It's a hot topic today, but it's so important because listen to this. This is very important. Knowing who you are is vital if you're going to have value in life. Let me say that again. You need to know who you are if you want to have value in your life. If you feel today that you have no value as a person, if you feel you have no value as an employee, if you feel you have no value as a spouse, if you feel you have no value as a parent, if you feel you have no value as a friend, if you feel you have no value as a member of our church community, or if you feel you have no value as a member of our local community, if you can't see your value, it could be because you don't know who you are. Because if you know who you are, you have value. But if you don't know who you are, then it's hard to find value. So that's what Paul is going to remind us of today. He's going to help us with our identity. So you need to know that he's going to start off this passage. I'm going to read this first set of verses to you in just a moment. But he's going to basically say, you're not who you used to be. Okay, let me read this. Colossians chapter 3, starting in verse 1, goes like this. Since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven, where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of the earth, for he died to this life. For you died to this life, and your real life is hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, is revealed to the whole world, you will share in all his glory. Has anyone ever watched those movies, Back to the Future? I don't know if anyone's ever watched those before, but there's a whole series of them, and it's a story about Marty McFly, and every movie that they put out, it's the same story, really. Marty has something happen in his life, and if he goes back into the past with a time machine that happens to be a DeLorean, he goes back in the past, and he can fix it through all sorts of misadventures, and he can make things right. Wouldn't it be amazing if we could just look at our past and go back in time and just fix it? Wouldn't that be awesome? Because all those things that you regret and all those things that you wish you could change, you could just kind of go back in time and fix things up and then come back to the present and be made perfect. Well, you can't. You can't. That movie, just so you know, if you thought that movie was real, it's not, okay? That's not a real movie. Because we can't do those kinds of things. And that we can't change our past at all. But when we choose to follow Jesus, Paul paints a picture of new life. And have you ever thought about what that means? New life is that picture of innocence and wonder and discovery and hope. That's what you see when we're in springtime right now, and you see the calves that have been born, and you see new life coming up with the buds on the trees, and you see new life, and it gets a picture of hope. And that's the picture of a new identity in Jesus Christ that Paul is speaking about, where you say, it says in verse 3, you die to your old self, or you die to your life. You die to your old self, and you get a chance to get rid of what's old and discover what your true identity in Jesus Christ is. It means the old is gone, and it's forever gone. It's kind of like a funeral. I don't know if you've ever been to a funeral before. I've done quite a few funerals. But funerals are really good. They're really hard. And they're really tough. But they're so important for bringing a freshness and a newness and a healing that has to happen in a person and in a family. But when you have a funeral and you bury the body of the deceased, I can tell you without certainty, life will never be the same again. Life will never be the same again. But the great part is that there's a newness that comes from that. There's a healing that comes from this that we can't even explain. And when we die to our old self, we're going to talk about what that means in just a moment, but when we die to our old self and lose our old identity, the stuff that you want to get rid of, that stuff that you say, I wish I could go back in time and change, the amazing thing happens. And Paul says in the last part of that passage I just read, he says, you can share in his glory and it gives you new hope. Gives you new hope. This past week, I did something I thought I'd never do. I sold my motorbike. You know that green motorbike you see everywhere in all the pictures I have? It's gone. Me and that old girl, we had many adventures. It was pretty amazing. But it was holding me back because there was something new that I wanted to experience in my motorcycle career. Can you call it a career? My motorcycle adventures or whatever it may be, there's something that I wanted to experience. And the bike that I had wasn't cutting it anymore. So I put my bike up for an ad in Kijiji, and I had a fair price listed on it. And a young guy from Calgary pulls up in his U-Haul truck that he rented, a pickup truck that he rented, with a U-Haul trailer in the back that he had rented. And he says, let me see your bike. He didn't bring a helmet or nothing to test drive it. And I said, here, take my helmet and take it for a spin because you're not going to buy it from me unless you take it for a spin at least. And so he took it for a spin and he loved it. His first motorbike he was ever buying. And I helped him load it up. He didn't have a clue how to tie it down to his trailer or anything, you know? And so I just helped him do all that stuff. And then he gets in his truck and I gave him all the extra oil I had for it and extra filters and everything I had extra, I just threw in with that bike. And he pulled away. And I can honestly say, I think I almost wanted to shed a tear. Because there's my bike that I just loved for the last 8-9 years. It had gone on so many adventures with me. And it was pulling down the back alley and around the corner. I did see it again because he got lost and he came back for directions, but then he left again. And my bike was gone. In a metaphorical sense, it was buried. I'll never have that bike again. And it's not coming back. But I had to sell it. I had to bury it so I can move on to the new adventures that are in store for me. If I would have kept it, I would never be in a position, in this case financially, to move into something else that I wanted to get. So I had to make that step. And if that is really what our new identity in Christ is like, there comes a point where we have to say the old is dead. It is gone. I bury it. It's finished. It's not coming back. Because I want something new in my life. I'm not content with the old anymore. Because Christ says, we're not who we used to be. Do you ever wonder what needs to die? Keep reading this passage. It says in Colossians 3, verse 5 to 10, it goes like this. So put to death the sinful earthly things lurking within you. Have nothing to do with sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires. Don't be greedy, for a greedy person is an idolater, worshiping the things of this world. Because of these sins, the anger of God is coming. You used to do these things, this is verse 7, you used to do these things when your life was still part of this world. But now is the time to get rid of anger, malice, rage, malicious behavior, slander, and dirty language. Don't lie to each other, for you have stripped off the old sinful nature and all its wicked deeds and put on a new nature and been renewed as you learn to know your Creator and become like Him. When I was in the States, there was something about me that stood up and people could look at me and say, you're a Canadian. And when you have an identity in Jesus Christ, there's something that stands out and people are caused to notice. And when people notice something, it's not because there's something that you give that's so awesome that you just have this glow about you, but it's because something is missing. Something is gone. And people notice that. Because I don't care what walk of life you're from. You can be one of the most horrible people in the land. No one likes someone who's immoral according to standards. No one likes someone that's impure according to their standards. No one likes anyone that's lustful or has evil desires according to their standards. Everyone hates greed that goes against the culture that you're a part of. And those are the things that if you don't have in your life, people stand up and notice because very few people function like that. And it can be all summed up in one word, Paul says, it's called idolatry. Idolatry is anything and anyone that is more important to you than God. That's what it is. Followers of Jesus, we want to worship Jesus, but the pressures of our society are so deep, and it keeps telling us that you should keep hanging on to your old self. Don't bury it, keep it, hang on to it. But you can't have your old life and your new life if you love your old life more than you love Jesus. You see, when God made this earth, he made it good. He made everything perfect in it. And everything we see is part of God's creation. Even the things that we make are because God has made us good. The problem is that whether it's possessions, whether it's relationships, whether it's family, it can all get corrupted. It can all get corrupted. Not because relationships and even intimate relationships are bad, because God says they're good, but they get corrupted because we desire them more than we desire God. And it really messes everything up. And it turns those areas that should have been so pure and so holy, even the employment that we have, the things that we're blessed with, if we put them in front of God, all of a sudden, we become immoral, we become impure, we become lustful, we have evil desires, and we're full of greed because we live for our pleasures and not his, and we're at risk. We're at risk of conforming to the world that's around us. So we need to do a gut check. And a good place to start is that list of items that Paul writes about. So we're going to do that right now. And any of you that are listening today, do you have any anger? Do you have negative feelings towards someone or something? Do you have malice? Malice is hoping bad for somebody. What about slander? Are you speaking badly about somebody or something in order to put them down? I tell you, malice and slander, if you want to see it, just go to Facebook. I am serious. We live in a world right now where it feels like, everyone's against us, including our government. And the remarks I hear on there, all it is point towards someone that's saying, I want what's best for me, instead of saying, let's get down on our knees and pray for our leadership. Let's pray for our government. Let's lift them up instead of tearing them down. But that's our old self. That's the old nature. That's our old, sinful nature coming through. What about filthy language? Or lying? Not telling the truth? Those are the areas that need to die in our lives, Paul says. They need to be buried. And if we hang on to those things, we don't work on getting rid of them, because sometimes we're scarred people, we're hurt people, we're injured people, and we need to take time to work on those things. And if we're not working on them, what has happened is wrecking our identity as Jesus through Jesus Christ, and people will see it, and people will know it, because new life says the old is gone. And new life brings innocence and wonder and discovery and hope. But the old life crushes hope. So folks, I'm being very, very serious here. This is not just some sermon that you preach and that you kind of pick out and say, I'm going to give the people this. This is just a list of, I'm just going through this book, and this is just kind of what's showing up. And I have to do justice as a pastor and say, this is what needs to be said. But if you are dead to Christ and you want to be alive, if you want to have a new identity, the first thing you need to do to have hope is to put to rest and start to have a funeral for those things that are the old you. They are dragging you down, and they're keeping you from being a new creature and a new creation that Jesus Christ wanted you to be. Now, here's the crazy part, is that Paul writes this letter not to the pagans in Colossae, not to the ones that were sacrificing people in the temples and having prostitutes in the temples. That's not who he's writing this letter to. He's writing it to the church. The church that's under pressure, the church that's at risk, and is no different than the church at McDougal Chapel. Brothers and sisters, have you put to death those sinful areas? The ones that are stealing your hope, the ones that aren't, if you have no value in your life, it's probably because you don't know what your identity is. And are you putting to death those things that are stealing your identity and keeping you from being alive and trying to follow Jesus? If this is you and you know what changes need to be made, it's time to get rid of them. It's time to put them to rest. It's time to have a funeral. And funerals are hard. And they aren't easy. And they bring a lot of pain. But you can't have new life until the old is gone. And what it's called in Scripture, the Christianese word for it, is to repent. To change your direction. To say, this is the old way of thinking, and now I'm going to go with a new way of thinking. New life in Christ happens when we say that everything that we have moves in a direction that honors Jesus Christ. When I got married, I stood at an altar in a church just like this, and I stood in front of my wife, and I stood before God, and I did what was called, had a covenant with her. And I had a covenant with God. And the covenant kind of goes through with sickness and in health and in richer and in poor and for better or for worse. And what that means is that no matter what life threw at us, we were going to stick it out together. And that's what a covenant is. Now, a covenant with Jesus Christ, that time where you say, Lord, I want to follow you, is no different. It's for sickness, in sickness and in health, for better or for worse, or for richer or poorer, it doesn't matter. Every part of it you need to know is the same when you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, because you're committed through a covenant to Jesus Christ to saying that I'm willing to go wherever you want. And part of that covenant means the old self is gone and the new is here. Paul finishes off that passage, and listen to this. And this is the passage I read at the beginning of the service. It goes like this. It says, in this new life, it doesn't matter if you are a Jew or Gentile, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbaric or uncivilized, slave or free. Christ is all that matters, and he lives in all of us. Christ becomes our everything. And not just in our words, not just little pieces of us, but everything. And he's saying that it doesn't matter your race, it doesn't matter your nationality, it doesn't matter your position of life, it doesn't matter your position in society, it doesn't matter, none of that matters. All that matters is that you say, Jesus Christ, it's all yours. So the question I have to ask again is, what needs to die so you can have hope? Because if you don't know who you are, you will never find your value in your life. Some people think that following Jesus is all about rules and do's and don'ts, and I want to tell you it's the exact opposite. Following Jesus is about freedom. It's about freedom, about trusting a God so much that you say, I'm willing to take you, I'm willing to follow you anywhere that you take me. And that's where you find freedom. You don't give up anything when you say, I follow Jesus. You may think you give up something, but that's just because you're hanging on to the old self. You might say, I got to give up my weekends, or I got to give up my parties, or I got to give up the fun times, or I got to give up, you know, all those things they hang on to, but you're not giving that up. Those are just anchors that are weighing us down. And we don't ever experience true freedom until we say, God, it's all yours. Paul's on to something. He's talking to a church that's feeling some pressures. They're at risk of who knows where that church is going to go, no different than our church. And we're going to get into this more next week, but he's just saying, make sure you know who you are. And if you're a follower of Jesus, that old is gone. Get rid of it, bury it, because there's new things coming that are going to give you hope. So I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray for everyone that's listening. I've probably gone a little longer than I usually do, but that's what happens when you get into some good preaching. That's what happens. But I just want to make sure you know that if you have never had hope before, the solution is just give your life to Jesus. And if you are a follower of Jesus that doesn't feel like you have value, then I challenge you. What is it that you're holding on to that's not giving you value? What's keeping you from finding your identity in Christ? And I want you to pursue that. Look for truth. The truth will set you free, Jesus says. The truth will set you free. Look for that. I'm just going to pray. Heavenly Father, you've heard the words of your servant, God. I just wanted to make those yours. I just pray you would just take them and take them wherever you need to. And I just want to pray for everyone that's listening today, whether in this room or online, wherever it may be. God, I just want to pray that we would all find value in life. But also, Lord, I just pray that we would listen to the words that Paul wrote to this church that was just being pulled in many directions. And I pray that we would just say, Lord, I want to have value. I want to have new life. Help me to be brave enough to get rid of my old life. Some of us have been following Jesus for years and we're still hanging on to the old. God, I just pray that we would be brave enough to let it go. And sometimes if we need help, whatever it means, Lord, someone to walk beside you, whatever it is, that we would find that so we can have new hope. And Lord, there might even be someone listening here today that has never had hope. And I just pray that that person and those people would just simply, in the quietness of their heart, just say, Lord, I surrender to you. I want that new hope. Make me new. Make me fresh. So, Lord, that's my prayer. Amen. If you have any questions about anything I said, I'd love to hear from you. You can text me. You can phone me. You can email me. It doesn't matter. Go to McDougallChapel.com and find the information how to contact me. I'd love to hear from you. But if you're the Holy Spirit speaking to you, don't leave this moment without making things right. I'm going to ask the worship team to come and lead us in the last song.
The land that was slain for the sins of the world.
Well, I can't wait to see what God's going to do with our church and with each one of us as we learn what it means to follow him and learn what it means to have an identity that says, I belong to Jesus Christ. And so as you have a great week, as you rest in his goodness, rest in his grace, rest in his value for you. He values you so much. I ask the Lord would bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God give you his precious peace. Amen.